Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Welcome to the Academy for Teachers, Master Classes, Jazz as Global Experiment with Arturo O’Farrill. My name is Bill Apollo Brown, and I'm a composer, musician, and educator. I have taught piano, jazz studies, orchestral, and concert band music. Presently, I teach piano and concert band at the Harvest Collegiate High School in the West Village. I'm also a proud fellow of the Academy for Teachers. As you know, an organization that honors and supports teachers by organizing amazing classes like this one. At my first master class, it was inspiring to be with other exceptional music teachers and create music from our cultures and our namesake, lessons that enhanced our teaching skills with our students. I left that master class that evening on a high with new ways to create and make music with my students. I've been given an honor tonight to introduce Arturo O’Farrill. His musical experience is definitely vast. He's an outstanding pianist, composer, and educator. I was lucky to attend one of his concerts at City Center in 2018. At that concert, he performed with his Afro-Latin jazz orchestra, and they were awesome. With a Latin America's first all-female string orchestra. They were also amazing. And other exceptional musicians, including a Havana rapper and a Latino dancer, tap dancer. It is evident to me that Arturo uses his musical expertise to expand beyond the concert hall through his compositions, his projects, his concerts, and his musical presentations. He is definitely an ambassador of worldwide humanity and culturalism. But Arturo's not the only star of this masterclass. It is also my honor to introduce the 24 distinguished teachers here today who were selected from many applicants. This is an impressive group with advanced degrees in music, the arts, theology, humanities, and education. They teach K through 12 in public schools, charter schools, and independent schools. Some of the music courses taught are music theory and appreciation, music history, chorus, band, piano, and wind and jazz ensembles. Courses also have been taught from American literature to government and politics to race and relations. There's a lot of teaching experience in this masterclass. We've been in the classroom between 4 and 48 years. The total number of years we've been teaching, could you believe, is 364? We teach between 60 and 550 kids. The number of children who know our names is 4,056, and that's this year alone. So your real audience today, Arturo, are those 4,056 students, because every teacher here will in some way share with them what we learned from you. This is a rippling effect of a masterclass, and it is certainly amazing. Thank you, Arturo O’Farrill, for being here. Thanks to my fellow teachers for your awesome teaching. And with that, let's let this masterclass begin.
Thank you so much. Let me begin by saying something you hear all the time, but that you probably don't know how real people feel, that in the pantheon of heroes, teachers are at the top for me. I'll tell you a little story. Back in 9/11, I woke up to the sound of George Bush saying the second plane had hit the towers. And my children were going to Brooklyn New School on Henry Street. And my son Zach and Adam were in class during those moments. And of course I just jumped in my car to go fetch them. And I walked into the office and the lady who signs out the kids was hysterical. She was in complete hysterics. She was barely functional. There were parents in the hallways screaming and wailing. I walked up to the top floor where my son was, and there was this class, and in the back of the class, because of the building and its placement in Brooklyn, faced the towers. And so these kids had their backs to a plate glass window, a huge plate glass window that showed these buildings in flames. And the teacher, Jacqueline, just was calm, focused, concentrated, and showed such grace and repose. And she had the kids focused, and she would not let them interact with the horror that was taking place behind them. Thank you. You guys are heroes. Sorry. So, I'm sorry. So I'm going to tell you what. I'm going to play for you while I can gather myself together, okay? I'm just play a little music. Okay, that gave me a moment to compose myself. I'm sorry, I got so emotional. So my talk to you today is actually jazz as global experiment, but it's more about jazz as global citizenry and how I think that jazz is a gift from an enslaved peoples. It's not localized to the United States. It's not localized to Latin America. It's a gift of an enslaved people, and I've known that my whole life. And so just to kind of get into the meat of the topic, I'm going to give you kind of a quick, brief bio. My father was Chico O'Farrill, who was born in Havana, and he met my mother, Lupe, in Los Angeles and moved to New York in 1964. Yes, I am that old. And, of course, like every good little dutiful son, I had to take piano lessons from the famous, you know, because my father was a famous jazz musician. And I started studying at the Manhattan School of Music pre-college division and eventually got into the High School of Music and Art. So the first thing that happened is that I just loved Elton John. I And that was my thing, man. My mother and father had me studying Mozart, and they'd had me studying Bach and Beethoven, and I loved Elton John. And I thought that was it. That was all the real music that I cared about. And my father was also a strange human being. He had his record collection under lock and key. Now, you know this. You're teachers. What's the first way to get kids to break into something? Put it under lock and key. So the first thing, as soon as I could, I got into the living room, which, by the way, was also locked a lot of the time. But it's a strange, strange household. The first thing that I did was break into the record collection and pull out a record. And I pulled out a record and saw a man who just looked, I didn't know, the look on his face was freaking me out. This was Miles Davis. And the first thing I saw and the first thing I heard when I played it on, when I put it on, was this. I'll just play you just a taste of it. And that was the beginning of the end of my life, or rather the beginning of my life. Because soon after that head, which is Seven Steps to Heaven by Miles Davis, takes place, George Coleman begins to play. And I'd never heard anything like that in my life. And I had no idea where it was coming from. And right after George Coleman plays, Herbie Hancock played. And literally at the age of 12, something happened to me that I'll never forget. It felt like an epiphany. I thought the clouds had parted and the voice of God had called me and said, "You must learn how to play jazz." So I fell in love with what I didn't know at that point was African rhythmic code. It's very different from the way that we're taught to think of music. I'm a classically trained pianist, composer, arranger, and I have a national reputation for creating Afro-Latin, international reputation for creating Afro-Latin jazz music. But the truth of the matter, in my life, in my soul, I live in a place that's very specifically a pueblo, a village, an African enslaved, from the African enslavement. I think all of us are descendants of that. I think all of us who listen to funk and salsa and jazz, we're all listening to, and it's been written about in a book called Secular Devotion. It's been written about the fact that a lot of the rhythms that end up becoming core rhythms to funk and salsa and Latin and jazz are actually African religious derived rhythms. And so it's really important to me, and I needed to understand this very, very early on in my journey, that and Baba Randy Weston, the great pianist, also said to me, "Listen, what you're doing is you're playing African music." So that was the beginning of a strange sense of my journey. I also began to find myself also feeling alienated. I came to this country at the age of 4 and was a little Mexican boy who didn't really speak English well until he was about 4 and a half. And then I didn't communicate with anybody until I was 7 or 8 because I just felt other. And I'm sure you see these children in your classrooms. I just could not communicate because I just felt so other. And this first feeling of alienation lasted throughout most of my education, my primary, secondary, and high school education. So this sense of other, this sense of not being the dominant culture, this sense of discovering Miles Davis, this sense of having an angry and a revolutionary stance, all drifted into view as I listened more and more to jazz. And then what I realized is that there's two jazzes. There's the jazz that they teach you about, which has to do with swing, and it has to do with proclaiming jazz as America's contribution to art. And there's the jazz that we ascribe to the masters of jazz. And then there's the jazz that really exists, the jazz that has always been Africa. It's always been about a story of oppression and a grace and love that is returned for oppression. And it's the story that I first began to be aware of when I heard Herbie Hancock play Black Rhythm Code, African Rhythmic Code in Seven Steps to Heaven. So now I know that you're all deeply impressed by PowerPoint. I understand that. So I'm going to take over the screen, if I may. And I hope I have those hosting duties. By the way, I'm very proud of my PowerPoint skills. They're so elementary. I just shout with glee when I make something jump out of the screen. This is just so much fun. Okay, so I'm going to take over the screen. I'm going to go to my PowerPoint. I'm gonna start it. Okay, ready? This is slick. Are you ready? Jazz as global citizenry. Yay! And what happens is that I started listening to the music of such revolutionary musicians as Billie Holiday, Louis Armstrong, and Charles Mingus. And you might be thinking to yourself, what are those, like, such central conservative jazz heroes? But they're not. They're actually revolutionary anarchists, and I'll prove it to you. First thing that I remember being about 16 or 17 was listening to Charles Mingus and his performance of Fables of Phoebus. And I will, by the way, there's something that's a little thing that me and Cornel West made up. It don't mean a thing if it ain't got that sing. Dr. Cornel West. And yeah, Arturo O'Farrill too. I have a record out now, which I hope you'll enjoy. It's called Four Questions. And it's a concerto that I wrote for Maestro West. It's really fun. I watched him speak and he blew me away. And so I asked if I could write him a concerto, and he said, sure. Anyway, Charles Mingus's piece, the Fables of Phoebus, really kind of destroyed me, because it speaks very clearly to an event in history. An event that you're all familiar with. And these are the words of, this is the description. In September 1957, Arkansas Democratic Governor Orville E. Phoebus became the national symbol of racial segregation when he used the Arkansas National Guardsmen to block the enrollment of 9 black students who had been ordered by a federal judge to desegregate Little Rock Central High School. His action created a national crisis, with President Dwight D. Eisenhower finally ordering federal troops to Little Rock to ensure the judge's order was obeyed to protect the black students and maintain order for the remainder of the school year. In the speech below, and I want you to listen to the speech and compare it to our present administration. In the speech below, Phoebus defends his actions and calls for continued resistance to racial integration in what he calls an all-powerful, intrusive federal government. From his speech, to the students who are concerned, I say that in the years to follow, when you have come to realize the importance of maintaining our form of government and the importance of preserving the great freedoms and privileges which we have known, you will be happy and proud to remember that you suffered inconvenience and personal sacrifice and thereby made a worthwhile contribution to the maintenance of our dual system of government. And it's really scary to think about the words of Governor Phoebus and to compare them to the words of Donald Trump. And the insistence on denying the existence of a virus, the insistence of manipulation of a public by fear, division, and deception. Now, this is that was the first time I listened to Charles Mingus and Fables for Phoebus. But I went and discovered that there's actually a precedence for there being very strong political messaging in jazz. These are the words of Charles Mingus's Fables of Phoebus. And I'm going to really quickly get out of this stop share thing for a second so I can play you some of this music. I know you can see my screen. I won't be able to speak after I switch into listening mode. But let me find it really quickly. This is Charles Mingus' Fables of Faubus. It's a little faint, so I hope you're in a quiet place to hear it. I will stop somewhere at about 2 minutes and 39 seconds. You will no longer hear me.
So sick and ridiculous. Drinks, don't rattle your ice in your glasses and don't ring the cash register. You got it covered? All right. I'd like to continue this set with a composition dedicated to the first or second or third All-American heel, Faubus, and it's titled The Fables of Faubus. Oh, Lord, don't let him shoot us. Oh, Lord, don't let him stab us. Oh, Lord, don't let him torn feather us. Oh, Lord, no more swastikas. So those are some very powerful words, and they radicalized me. And I started thinking about what Charles Mingus was trying to communicate in the presence of politics in music. And then I realized there was a precedence for this. There was a precedence for politics in music, and it can go back as far as Louis Armstrong. I'm going to go now to a piece of music that he made famous. So we think of Louis Armstrong, we think of the father of jazz, the all-American nationalized version of jazz. But Louis Armstrong Pops was a radical who did go on State Department tours, but also refused to go on State Department tours because of governmental policies. He was also, of course, a son of New Orleans, and he was very, very, very outspoken. He was very clear about his politics and his social views. And so I'm going to play you just a little bit of his piece, What Did I Do to Be So Black and Blue? Thank you.
empty bed. Spring's heart is lead. Feel like old Ned. Wished I was dead. What did I do to be so black and blue? Even the mouse ran from my house. They laugh at you and scorn you too. What did I do to be so black and blue? I'm white inside, but that don't help my case. 'Cause I can't hide what is in my face. Buzz, how would it end? Ain't got a friend. My only sin is.
There's just something so heartbreaking about the verse, my only sin is my skin. And it, that, again, discovering that piece of music even further radicalized my association of jazz as something that not only did not belong to one people, that belonged to the spirit of overcoming oppression and hatred and returning hatred and love and grace for hatred and oppression. And I think sometimes that lesson is really missing from contemporary jazz education. I think sometimes it is overlooked because we talk about skill sets, we talk about aesthetics, we talk about nationalism, but we don't really talk about the fact that the history of jazz is built on the death and on the blood of many enslaved peoples. And I'll never forget taking a group of students down to Cuba who were all jazz musicians, and going to a place in Matanzas that was a slave-holding place. And these young musicians were learning notes and scales and history and all this stuff, but nothing impacted them until they picked up one of these, I forget what they call them, the things that hold, that they would attach to an enslaved person when they tried to run away. I forget what it's called, but it's this big, heavy piece of metal attached to wood, and it's all of a sudden, the tears came out of their eyes as they understood that the music they were playing came from the death and bloodshed of many, many an enslaved person. And I think that sometimes we, as educators, especially in jazz education, really forget that there's more to this lesson than there's more to this lesson than just notes and scales and American creativity. Okay, I'm going to continue. We're all very familiar, of course, with Billie Holiday's incredible Strange Fruit. But I want to tell you a quick story before we just listen to a little bit of it. I'm sure you're all familiar with it, but I just want to. The spirit of this music, the spirit of Fables of Faubus, the spirit of Louis Armstrong is not just in the messaging, but in the majesty of the musical expression. These are also incredible artists. And to marry the social and political and historical meaning to their art, I think, is not only a huge feature of what they do, but it's part of what I wrote about in the article that I had you read, which is this idea that the messaging can't be clothed in elitism. Jazz was born in music in bordellos and in bars and in speakeasies. And something was lost in the translation to institutions of glass and chrome. Something was lost along the way that I think we need to recover, especially as we teach young people that jazz is actually music that questions society. Now, the reason I tell you that is because I was giving a lecture in a very elite place. I was giving a lecture at in NYU Abu Dhabi. And I was lecturing to very definitely mixed audience of internationals, including many Middle Eastern people and Persian Gulf people. And when I played this example of Billie Holiday's song, a woman in a full religious garb started to weep. In full religious garb, started to weep. And I couldn't help but think about the power of not just Billie Holiday's incredible musical genius, but the way she married it with the messaging of this horrendous moment in American history, and that it would reach across thousands of miles and thousands of years and touch the heart of someone who had no experience with the American tragedy of enslaved peoples. That was a very telling moment for me, and I realized that this music called jazz is more powerful than we even can begin to understand. This is Strange Fruit. So that powerful experience got me to think about a lot of different realities. And then I discovered, I'll go back to playing my incredibly cool. So about 6 years ago, a board member of my nonprofit, the Afro-Latin Jazz Alliance, which does incredible artistic education, performance, and residency work in New York City public school system as well, sent me an article about a man named Jorge Francisco Castillo. Some of you have seen the film. And Jorge runs this festival, at the border between San Diego and Tijuana, and every year he gathers Son Jarochero musicians, also known as Afro-Mexican music, music that is born in Veracruz. It's really beautiful music, by the way. And I'll talk a little bit about that from a musicological standpoint, but I will say that he gathers these Son Jarocho musicians from all over the world and brings them together right at the border of San Diego and Tijuana. And they perform there in the presence of attack dogs, chicken wire, border guards, and a mesh so fine that you can barely stick your finger through it. And together, in this setting, they use the actual elements of hatred and division to celebrate life. They use that setting and those elements to sing and dance, zapatear, and to sing songs of freedom and liberation. And so I began to think a little bit about where that those sentiments came from and where the relationship between the United States and Mexico went wrong. And I came across some of this. Hold on, let me see if I can, I may have to escape this for a second. Okay, I'm going to make it small. Americans are largely unaware that Mexicans were frequently the targets of lynch mobs. From the mid-19th century until well into the 20th century, second only to African Americans in the scale and scope of the crimes. One case, largely overlooked or ignored by American journals, but not by the Mexican government, was that of seven Mexican shepherds hanged by white vigilantes near Corpus Christi, Texas, in late November 1873. The mob was probably trying to intimidate the shepherd's employer into selling his land. None of the killers were arrested. From 1848 to 1928, mobs murdered thousands of Mexicans through surviving records, though surviving records allow us to clearly document only about 547 cases. These lynchings occurred not only in the southwestern states of Arizona, California, New Mexico, and Texas, but also in states far from the border like Nebraska and Wyoming. Such episodes were not isolated to the turbulent gold rush period. More than a half century later, on November 3rd, 1910, a mob snatched a 20-year-old Mexican laborer, Antonio Rodriguez, from a jail in Rock Springs, Texas. The authorities had arrested him on charges that he had killed a rancher's wife. Mob leaders bound him to a mesquite tree, doused him with kerosene, and burned him alive. The El Paso Herald reported that thousands turned out to witness the event. We found no end of evidence that anyone was ever arrested. So the relationship between the United States and Mexico is long and storied and filled with love and hatred and violence and anger. Some of you may know that large swaths of the Southwest were actually originally Mexican land. And through various purchases and wars and battles, it slowly fell into American hands. Thus was born the idea of going to Mexico to celebrate with Jorge Francisco Castillo the Fandango Fronterizo, which is the celebration that he holds every year at the border. And at first it became just kind of an idea that I went to my producer and said, let's do this. And he said, well, let's go and visit. And I went to Jorge's house in Tijuana and learned about this music. And thus was born the Fandango Doctrine. The Fandango Doctrine is very simple. The Fandango Doctrine is high pinkies. See my hand? See the hole that your finger can barely pass through? That other side of my hand is the U.S. side. And so the Fandango Doctrine is the idea that we celebrate our divisions in the presence of all the hatred, and with our celebrations and our community and our sense of Pueblo and life, we actually destroy the very elements that that keep us apart. I'm going to show you, these two gentlemen here are brothers. They are part of the Villalobos brothers, and they're playing across, I don't think this is in the film, they're playing across the mesh. And the reason they're not playing on the same side of the mesh is because one of them could not get a visa. And this is repeated day in and day out. But I want you to just look at the joy of these brothers as they play across the mesh. Thank you. And that's the actual scene. That's exactly what it looks like. At the Fandango Fronterizo. Families playing across the border to each other. It's actually quite moving. Let me go on and just go on. Brother separated by visas, but united by a wall. And I know that most of you saw this film, but just in case you didn't, this is just a small taste of it. I don't know what I'm doing with my sound. Somehow my sound got to... 1, 2. You still hear me, right? Okay. I want to make sure I don't... So this is the result of that visit to the Fandango Fronterizo was the motion picture that you saw on HBO Max, Fandango at the Wall, and also a book, a very good book about the nature of the relationship between the United States and Mexico, and an album called Fandango at the Wall, which features an incredible cast of people that came with us to Mexico, including MacArthur Fellow Regina Carter, Golden Globe nominee Antonio Sanchez, the Afro-Latin Jazz Orchestra, Rahim Alhaj, Saba Motilevi from the Persian Gulf, incredible cast of thousands. This is the power of jazz. This is why I say jazz is global citizenry. The idea of bringing jazz and son jarocho music together is part of the responsibility of those of us who are called jazz musicians. It is our job. It is absolutely our job to see that the message of Africa, that the message of an enslaved people, it continues to spread throughout the world, returning love and grace for violence and oppression. I spoke with Cornell just 4 or 5 weeks ago, and he said something that rocked my world again. I said, what do we do, Cornell? What do we do in this time period of hatred and violence and murder and death? And he said, we got to overcome by over-love. We be overcoming by over-loving. And that's, I think, the message of jazz, to overcome by love.
I fell in love with this idea of people coming together, using that primal connection of music and culture to destroy barriers and remove borders.
So I want to definitely make sure I leave enough time for folks to ask questions. Let me just, I think I turned off the sound here. This should be Scarlet, right? Yeah, I had it. Okay, I'm back in Scarlet, my interface. This whole technology thing is also a border. The border that I'd have to cross every day. And frankly, it's almost as bad as having to present your papers. But I think I got it together. So I definitely want to take a minute and also tell you that this thing called music is also interspecies. I know you're going to find this hard to believe, but this is a story that no one knows from the making of the film. We were rehearsing in a courtyard in Tijuana, and we walked out, and you know, Tijuana has a tradition of dancing horses, famous dancing horses. And we walked out of the rehearsal into the streets of Tijuana, and I saw a horse's butt sticking out down the street. And for some reason, it occurred to me that this was one of those famous dancing horses. So I went to the man who was handling the horse, and I said, "Do you think the horse will jam with us?" Let me go on. And this is literally happened. This literally happened. The Afro-Latin Jazz Orchestra jamming with a horse. Out came the violins, out came the saxophones, out came... It's an interspecies jam session, y'all. That's the power of music. And then we brought this very event to New York. We brought the Fandango to Symphony Space and to the Prigones Theater. Okay, so I want to definitely make sure that we have time to... how international is the idea of jazz? Ned Sublett wrote a book called Cuba and its music, its people. And in the book, Ned talks a lot about how, in fact, he spends hundreds of pages not even getting to Cuba. He talks, he writes a lot about it, the idea that the nexus of Africa and Spain and the Moors and the Middle East is a place where a lot of performance practice gets created. And a lot of that performance practice gets transferred, unfortunately, via the enslaved people's roots, back and forth between the tip of Spain and the tip of Northern Africa, and eventually making its way into the performance practice of Western Africa and counter-influencing and counter-mingling all of these traditions. So that when the enslaved peoples are brought to the Americas, there is also a fair amount of performance practice that comes from the Middle East and even India. This idea perplexed me, and so I went to Kuwait on a fact-finding mission and found myself with some new friends, and I found the roots of my music, the roots of the music that I call jazz, which I think is such a silly word. Somehow I found the roots of that music in the Middle East as well. So these are my friends. I was given a speech to them. The Bill Bragan invited me to do this thing, this concert called Cuba Meets Caligi, the Middle Eastern Roots of Afro-Cuban Jazz. Remember, you heard it here first, okay? And so I went to visit a friend of mine in his home to meet his Kuwaiti pearl diving tradition percussionists. And he introduced me and said, this is Mr. O'Farrill. He wants to do a concert here with the Middle Eastern Roots of Afro-Cuban Jazz. He's going to have a few words with you. And I started to say, you know, I got very professorial, very academic, and I said the roots of our music is in Africa and the African drum, and together we united and blah, 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 blah. Well, the biggest brother there looked at me and said, well, you don't look African. So I said, okay, fine. I could take a little heat, no problem. I said, tell you what, man, teach me one of your rhythms, right? So he taught me a traditional clay pot rhythm from the Kuwaiti pearl driving tradition.
We don't have any sound on that. Does that one have
sound? You don't have sound? Oh, I'm so sorry. Okay, I'm going to play this through the speakers. You'll hear it better. Can you hear it now? Let me see if I can. I'm sorry, my whole technology thing here has come crashing down in a heap, in a flaming wreckage, in a chaotic moment of absolute disastrousness, which I love because that's what life is about. Can you hear me? You can. Okay, let me go back to this, and it should be going through the speakers. Can you hear that? So the vibe started to get nice. Folks were loosening up. And then I went and said, let me do this. Let me teach you one of my rhythms. So I began to teach them a mambo. And we played a mambo to a wawanko. And if you'll notice, these guys are on couches, most of them are squatting, and I'm still at the piano, which didn't feel right. It felt culturally wrong. So I joined them on the floor on a little red toy piano. And I'm gonna show you this moment where they really, where things get really loose and beautiful.
You're not sharing your screen.
You're not showing the screen. Okay, let me just escape. See if I can play this here. Can you see the screen now?
Not yet.
Okay. So that now you can see me sitting at the little red piano, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that was the way that I broke the ice culturally. I got down on the floor with the little red piano. But at one point, the things got particularly heated. And let me see if I can
go further in this piece. You can't do it with this. Can you see my screen? You can see it and you can hear it. I'm going to go back to sharing, and I'm going to go to the moment where it gets really hot and heavy. You got to watch the result, the exciting moment when the jam comes to a head. Now things are heavy, right? We're having fun. Everybody's looking at me. And then when I used the piano as a percussion toy, that was it. Watch. That guy with the big wide smile, that was the guy that was giving me a hard time. And the beautiful thing is, right after this, that big brother grabbed me by the skin, pinched my skin, looked in my eyes and said, "You're black, but you're white." And I understood what my life was about. What my life was really about. The idea that jazz is global is highly politicized. It means it cannot be nationalized. It cannot be used to justify political, religious, or philosophical ideology. This contradicts the typical institutional interpretation of jazz as American-born. Jazz is an African inheritance filtered throughout all the Americas and best realized as a universal and global music that speaks to the truth of love as a response to oppression and hatred. It also serves as a journalistic function, as does all art. So let me stop sharing this. Let me stop sharing screen. Let me go back to, I stopped sharing. Now I see you guys. I want to make sure we have some time for questions and comments and disagreements and hopefully challenges to my very carefully ordered system of understanding myself.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much for what we've heard so far. We are really excited to hear more in the coming weeks. But let's take a couple of questions here. And I think perhaps we should start with a broader question and then move to some more specific questions. So, Christian, I'm wondering if you'd like to state the question that you posed in chat.
Yeah. Sure, I'm happy. Thanks again for being here with us, Mr. O'Farrill. It's been really awesome getting to hear about all of this live. And so anyway, I just posed the question. You know, I am wondering if I agree. The word jazz, I kind of feel weird saying it nowadays because it is such an inclusive art form. And I'm just wondering your thoughts on, you know, in the next few years, do you think there's gonna be a shift in, you know, Is a high school jazz ensemble going to be called, or is it okay to call it a high school jazz ensemble? Do we need to start looking at another terminology or something more inclusive? And I was just curious of your thoughts.
No, I believe very much that the word jazz is both meaningless and meaningful. What we can do is we can talk about jazz and call it jazz and just expand the definition of it. The idea that jazz is uniquely American is gone. It was gone from the minute folks were enslaved and brought here. It was gone the minute it became more popular in Europe. It was gone the minute it became a huge item in Japan. It was gone when it began to be practiced by people like Miguel Zenon, and it was gone. It's always been a universal language, but it's an entry point. You can say impressionistic painting, and then check out Cézanne. You know what I'm saying? It's an entry point that I think high school jazz ensembles will always be called jazz ensembles. But the brilliant moment point of intersection is the educator, and the educator has the ability to say, this is the entry point, and there's all the definitions that I don't want to get rid of the word jazz. Some people do. Some people want to call it Black American music. Some people want to call all kinds of things. If you teach about the history of this music and where it's gone and where it's going. You can use it, it's just a word like any other word. That's my feeling about it.
Great. Let's take one more question for today. We'll see if we can squeeze out a little more time, but at least we'll take one more question for sure. So you've just heard from Christian, who teaches at the Berklee Carroll School, and I want to turn to Nokomo Morris, who teaches at Harvest Collegiate High School. Nokomo, do you want to pose your question?
Yeah, sure. Hello. Thanks for doing this for us. I'm feeling pretty cool. So I have a question about Boogaloo Salsa. I've been listening to Boogaloo Salsa a whole lot for the last few weeks, days, and I was looking into it and trying to figure out like why I love the sound of it so much. And I did a basic Wikipedia search and it was saying it uses some kind of African scale, and then it goes into all this tonic, tonic, monic sort of music theory words that I don't understand. So can you demonstrate a little bit about what that means and maybe explain it a little tiny bit?
Well, Boogaloo I hate to say this because it's going to sound very Boogaloo is really a strong New York contribution. The great progenitors of Boogaloo really come from New York, and it's a kind of just like salsa. A lot of people understand that there's two different kinds of salsa. There's Puerto Rican salsa and New York salsa. And both are musics that are derived from a very loose form of Afro-Cuban music. But Boogaloo is really a marriage of American soul and salsa. And in a very real way, it was practiced by people from the Bronx on street corners, where it was really kind of crystallized into a contemporary form of salsa. I love Boogaloo, and I think it's great, and it's great music. I've written Boogaloos, I've performed Boogaloos my whole life, and it is again, it's a point of entry. It's a point of, you pull on that thread, you will find a journey that will lead to so many places: New York, Puerto Rico, Cuba, Ghana, the Ivory Coast, and then up into Spain and back. It's just a beautiful entry point into a discussion of what this music is.
Excellent. Thank you so much. I think we're coming very close to the end of our time today. So I think we'll hold Matt's question until the next time. And so we've got two more meetings ahead of us. And the next of the meetings will be a chance for you as teachers to work together. And so I just want to let you know a little bit about what to expect for our next meeting. And it will, again, be time to work together. We'll start with three presentations, and then you'll spend time in small groups. So with that, I think, Arturo, you've left us all really just wanting more. And so usually we've got to say goodbye, farewell, but in this case, it's bye till we see you again. And so I want to thank you very much. And I want to also thank the teachers who were here with us today. And we look forward to seeing you all again very soon. All right. Thank you. Thank you, Arturo. And thank you to our teachers. We'll see you again.